our company isn't what it used to be. We now have fans, right. And it's a whole new thing. And I felt we ought to change the name, and change it to Marvel, because the first book that Martin ever published when I came to work there was called Marvel Comics.
Right.
So just out of sentiment, I called it Marvel.
Now, did you become editor-in-chief while Martin was still around, still alive?
Oh, I had always been. When Joe Simon and Jack Kirby left, when I was about 17 years old, Martin needed somebody to replace them. It was a small company. It was really Joe and Jack. So he said to me, can you handle being the editor while I look for a real person?
Right.
And I said, you know, when you're 17, what do you know? I said, sure, I can do it. He must have forgotten all about it, because I stayed there ever since. So I functioned as editor, art director, and head writer.
Now, when you become publisher and kind of turn over the writing reins, how involved do you stay at that point? Are you still looking over scripts or looking over the artwork still?
I have a theory. When you work with artists and writers, any kind of creative people, you get their best work if you let them do it the way they want to do it. Now, they have to be talented. If they're not talented, forget it.
Right.
But you get a guy with talent, you can't tell him too much. You can't say, don't do it this way, do it that way.
Right.
Gotta let him do it his way. Now, maybe that was an excuse for me being lazy, but I pretty much tried to keep hands off. Because, again, as I say, I was lucky. I had built up the greatest staff of artists and writers you could find anywhere.
And that was traditionally referred to as the Silver Age, but really was a golden age of comics.
It was
comics.
For me.
And this is the period before TV kind of takes over as much as it eventually does, and long before the video game, long before the internet. So kids are still reading comics like mad. And you are the ambassador of comics at that point, even to this day, of course. But at that point, I'm a kid in the 70s. You know Stan Lee, because if you go to a comic book show or if you read the Marvel bullpen, Stan's soapbox, you're everywhere. You're the face of comics. It's fair to say that you're the most well-known person in comics to people in the comics audience and people well outside the comics audience.
Well, you know, it's funny. At one point, I guess they didn't know what else to do with me, but I was made the president of Marvel. And I thought, oh, wow. President, now I'll really be able to do things the way I want to do them.
Right.
Didn't work out that way. I found that all that I was doing was going to financial meetings.
Right.
And I had to come up with what they call 3-year plans,
right.
5-year plans for the business. I'm a guy who doesn't know what I'm going to have for lunch the same day, and I had to have a 3-year plan.
Right.
And I suddenly realized I am doing something that millions of people can do better than I can do, which is financial stuff. And the thing I enjoy doing, the creative stuff, I'm not doing anymore. So as you can well imagine, I didn't stay president very long. I gave that up pretty fast, One other thing that I think Marvel did, and did very well, I tried to make the readers feel they're more than just casual readers.
Right.
But we're all part of a family. We're all part of an inner group. We're having fun and the outside world isn't aware of it.
Right.
And I tried doing that with the soapbox column I wrote, with the bullpen page.
Very much so. You kind of lifted the curtain between audience and the creators and said, this is what it's like here. Check it out. It invites the audience in and it does kind of create a familial feeling about it. And they'll follow you to the ends of the earth.
Did that very consciously. You know, before Marvel, as far as I know, no other comic company played up who wrote the story, who drew it, who lettered it, who edited it. Maybe this is why I'm so impressed with you. I mean, there are a lot of reasons.
Right.
I love movies. You are such a fantastic movie maker.
Thank you.
I wanted to make the comics seem to be like movies as much as possible.
Right.
And I thought, why not have screen credits?
Right.
So I started listing, written by Stan Lee, drawn by Jack Kirby. Then I thought, why not make it even warmer and more friendly? So it was suddenly written by Smilin' Stan, by Jolly Jack, by Sturdy Steve Ditko. I think he probably always hated that. John Romita, I called him Jazzy Johnny Romita, and then sometimes Johnny Ring-a-Ding Romita. I'm sure he hated it, but, well, I was the editor, I did it. So by giving everybody nicknames and putting their names there, and by writing the soapbox and the bullpen bulletins, and even with the mail, we were the first, I believe, to have letters pages, and the other companies did it too. But when, for example, DC would get a fan letter, the letter would be printed and it would say something like, "Dear editor,
right.
I didn't like this story," or "I did like this story," blah, blah, blah. Signed, Charles Brown.
Right.
And the answer would be, "Dear Charles, thank you for your letter. And sincerely, the editor," something right. like that. If I got the same letter, mm-hmm. I would cross out the word editor and I'd print it. It would say, "Dear Stan."
Right.
And for the signature, if it was Charlie Brown, I'd cross out Charles Brown. I'd write Charlie.
Right.
And in my answer, I'd make some sort of a gag.
Right.
You know, "Hey, glad you wrote. We thought we didn't have any readers. Now we know we have one."
Right.
Anything that was a gag.
Right.
So it was a little thing, but it was trying to give a feeling of warmth, mm-hmm. a feeling of friendliness. Mm-hmm. "Don't call me editor, call me Stan."
Right.
"And I don't want to call you Joe. I want to call you Joey."
Right.
You know, just whatever it is. And it seemed to work. Then we had a club. I decided we had so many fans, because mm-hmm. we were now getting a lot of fan mail.
Right.
Let's form a club. So again, I didn't want to do it in an ordinary way. So I started it out as a contest. Mm-hmm. I wrote that we're having a club. Mm-hmm. And that the name, the initials of the club's name would be MMMS. Mm-hmm. And I would keep this up in the bullpen bulletin page. And I said, "We'll give a prize for whoever guesses the name."
Uh-huh.
And I ran this thing for months, giving clues. Finally, we announced it was the Merry Marvel Marching Society.
Right.
We didn't know where we were marching to, but right. we were on the way.
Right.
And it's fresh on my mind, because a fan sent me a CD yesterday uh-huh. that I listened to of a record that we did. Those who joined the club, mm-hmm. in those days, you for a penny or less than a penny mm-hmm. each, you could make a little plastic record.
Right.
I marched the whole bullpen to a recording studio, uh-huh. and we tried to be funny for a few minutes. The corniest thing you ever right. heard. And I'm talking to Jack Kirby and Artie Simic and Sol Brodsky and all the guys. We were all trying to upstage each other.
Right.
It was ridiculous, but the fans loved it.
Sure.
They were listening to the voices of sure. the people whose stuff they had been reading.
It's like a forerunner of the DVD commentaries and behind-the-scenes exactly. stuff. Yeah.
yeah. And then this fellow on the record, he sent me something I forgot. We had a song. Uh-huh. "March along, march along, march along, march along with the Merry Marvel Marching Society. You'll belong, you'll belong," on and on. "And stand a little straighter, walk a little prouder. Be a something, be an innovator, talk a little louder. And where will you be then? You'll belong, you'll belong." It went on and on about the Merry Marvel Marching Society.
I mean, clearly.